prapanna parijataya totra vetraika panaye jnana mudraya krishnaya gita amruta duhe namaha om. Dear friends, welcome to the study of Gita. We are seeing the 18th chapter of the Gita, and there we were reading shloka number 53. So there the context is, Krishna had already told about what is called swabhava karma. Swabhava karma means, we know that every person is endowed with a particular nature, that is, whether it is a sattva guna, rajo guna or tamo guna. And depending on the nature with which a person is endowed, the society allots him or allocates him some karma. And then he keeps on doing it. And that is, by that way, he attains that antahkarana shuddhi. So antahkarana shuddhi is attained by doing swabhava karma, swabhavajam karma. So that is what he said. And thereafter, by doing that swabhavajam karma, in the same process, after attaining that chitta shuddhi is the primary step for the next level. We know that karma leads to chitta shuddhi. Karma, karma means that nishkama karma. Nishkama karma leads to chitta shuddhi. Chitta shuddhi enables a person to the next level, that is called jnana nishta. And there, from that jnana nishta, he attains oneness with Brahma. And also, all his actions become non-actions. Krishna used a word called naishkarmya siddhi, a rather tough word, naishkarmyam. That is actionlessness. You may be doing some action. For example, a king like King Janaka, an enlightened person, he may be doing some action. Or even Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna is engaged in so many actions. But then, outwardly, for all of us, they look like actions. But from his point of view, it is actionlessness. Or it is from something which is called, if you want to use a simple word, non-action. That is, those actions are not giving any fruit to him. They are not affecting him. So similarly, a jnani is somebody who may be doing something, the fruit of the action is not affecting him. So we are in that context. And he has been explaining what one has to do. And the shlokas number 51 to 53, I told you, they constitute one line, one full sentence. That is, buddhya vishuddhaya yukto, starting from 55, shloka number 51. 53 starts as, ahankaram balam darpam kamam krodham parigraham. We were actually reading this particular shloka. So this 51, 52 and 53, they constitute one full sentence. So there, what is he saying? So what exactly a person has to do after attaining chitta shuddhi? Again, what is the course of action? How he has to live? What should be his way of life? He told certain points. He gave certain conditions. Dhrutya, atmanam niyamya, having controlled his mind and indriyas, and having rejected all this shabdadin, vishayan, all the sense objects having rejected. And then again, vivikta sevi, vivikta, that is 52, we read it. Vivikta sevi is, that is seeking solitude. Then laghvasi, eating very light, yata vakkaya manasa, by controlling his mind, action and speech. Then dhyana yoga paraha, a person who is always contemplating on the nature of the self, atma vichara, that is atma swarupa vichara. So that is what he said, all these conditions. And 53 also, he is saying ahankaram balam darpam. So he has to quit, he has to give up ahankara. Ahankara is pride. Pride due to various reasons like scholarliness. He is a very great scholar or he is a great tapasvi. I have done so much of tapas, etc. That tapas also can lead to ahankara. So all that, even what is called spiritual pride or hubris. So ahankaram, balam again, similar, arising out of that same spiritual pride, balam. Darpa again is arrogance. Oh, I am so great, I am this, that, etc. Then kamam, krodham. We have seen these words quite often. Parigraham, yesterday we stopped here. Parigraham means accepting. Grahanam is the English word grab, graha. Grab, grubhnati, Sanskrit root, grubhnati is grabbing. That is, graha, parigraha is accepting. That is, suppose there is a Swamiji or some sannyasi or a jnani. Somebody comes and then says, okay, I am going to build you some house, some big ashram, etc., etc. I am going to donate so much of land, I am going to build an ashram for you. So all these things, they again bind a person. So a Swami, A jnani is supposed to perform only such actions which are needed for the maintenance of his body. That is, sharira yatra matra cheshtaha. That is, sharira yatra means the body has to continue. Jnani is not supposed to commit to suicide or anything. Then sharira yatra means the body mind complex has to continue. In order to continue that, he needs some food, he needs some water. To that extent, he may be doing some activity. Beyond that, maybe the latest example is probably the Nisargadatta Maharaj. Nisargadatta Maharaj, we know, some Western student has composed all his teachings in one book. He has collected all his teachings in one book titled, I Am That. So, it is something like Aham Brahmasmi only. Aham Brahmasmi in English, I Am That. So, that gentleman, if you see, Nisargadatta Maharaj, he is a very simple man. He's just a small shopkeeper and a very wise man. Whoever came, he told certain, he just spoke to them about what is reality, etc. And he's such an enlightened man. And he is just doing the sharira yatra matra cheshta. He is not avaricious. If he wanted, he could build up a huge ashram, etc. But he did not do that. So, parigraham is something which is a very, very tempting thing. Parigraha, somebody gives an agenda, sir, Swamiji, you have to build a huge ashram like this, you should have 100 students with you, and then all those 100 students, you have to train them, etc., etc. So, training a student again is a very big temptation. So, all these things will gradually lead to one after the other. So, that is the picture. Kamam, krodham, parigraham. Then, and that is the reason why this parigraha is also something which is prohibited for a grihastha also, for a good grihastha. In fact, even today we see several people who follow a particular vratam called aparigraha vratam. That vratam is a vow, let us say, V-O-W, vow. And that vow is aparigraha vratam. So, they do not accept. I have seen some people like that. Some very good, very pious people, some Vedic scholars and people like that, who do not accept anything, who just do not, you give him some 10,000 rupees or 1 lakh, whatever it is, they do not accept. They live with whatever is available to them, maybe some ancestral land or some house or whatever, some little property they have, and such meager, very, very frugal, most frugal living. So, that is what they do, even today. So, that is aparigraha vrata. Then, next line is vimuchya nirmamah shantah. What vimuchya? Ahankaram, balam, darpam, etc. Vimuchya. Vimuchya means vimochanam. We know that word vimochanam. Vimochanam means releasing. That is, vimuchya means having given up. Ahankaram, balam, darpam, kamam, krodham, parigraham, all these things have to be given up. What are all mentioned in the first line, they have to be given up. Vimuchya. Then how is he supposed to stay? Nirmamaha. He is supposed to stay in that state of nirmamatvam. Nirmama. Mama is mine. I and mine. Aham and mama. These are the two words which we frequently come across in Vedanta. Aham is I. Mama is mine. So, aham and mama. So, nirmama is somebody who is, when a person is identifying himself with the infinity, then where is the question of mama again? So, here we are talking about a jnani. We are talking about a person who has done some shravana, manana, etc. And such person who is trying to identify himself with that infinity, that is called Brahman. Then where is the question of the mine and aham, etc. So, that mama will automatically drops off. Not as though he is deliberately giving it up. They gradually fall off. Yesterday I was telling you the example of that god, Urvarukamiva Bandhanata, that ash god, which just drops off from that stem. And even that creeper is no longer willing to hold it. Creeper actually wants to drop it off. So, that is what nirmamaha. Shantaha. Shanta again comes from the root shama. Shama means antarindriya nigraha. So, here shanta is totally all those the activities of the sattva guna, rajoguna, tamoguna, they have all subsided. That is, even if there is sattva guna, even that sattva guna will provoke him to some activity. Sattva guna again is equally dangerous, because sattva guna, people say, sattva guna is like a golden shackles. If Rajoguna and Tamoguna are like iron chains, Sattvaguna is like golden chains. So whether a person is bound in gold chains, golden chains or in iron chains, it doesn't matter, a person is chained. So the Sattvaguna again binds him to certain actions. And those actions he keeps doing it, oh, I have to do this with a sense of kartavya, with a sense of kartrutva bhava, and this is my kartavyam, etc. Then he is again bound. So this shanta refers to that. That is a total actionlessness. And some examples commentators give the example of like a river merging in the ocean. Upanishads also give the example, yatha nadyas sandamano sandamana samudre sandamana samudre velayam gachanti. There is a line something like that. Samudre astam gachanti, that is, they disappear. The nadis, nadi means a river, all these rivers, they flow into the ocean. So long as it is a river, it has got a name, there is a shape, nama rupa. So once it enters the ocean, nama rupe vihaya, that is, the nama and rupa, they just dissolve. So similarly, the jnani, for the jnani also, till he became a jnani, there was a name and form. That aham, it had some address. That aham had some address, I am this, I am that, etc., etc. But once he is a jnani, that address is gone. He may still have his passport, he may still have his visa for worldly purposes. But then, his address is gone. From his point of view, his address is gone. From others' point of view, his address is there. His address is very much there from the point of view of the immigration officer or some visa officer. But then, his identity is, from his point of view, it has disappeared. We'll just take a break and come back. Let us come back. We are seeing the word shanta. And the commentators give the example of rivers, they just flowing into the ocean. Nama rupe vihaya. In fact, we also saw the same metaphor in the second chapter of the Gita. All these rivers, they go and join the ocean, and the ocean is something which doesn't undergo any change. All the rivers, they flow into, in the world, all the rivers flow into the ocean, except maybe a few. But still, the river, the ocean doesn't get any change, it doesn't change. The ocean keeps the same. So like that, like the ocean of consciousness, this particular, this jnani does not undergo any vikara, does not undergo any change. And then nirmamaha shantaha, then brahma bhuyaya kalpate, brahma bhuyaya means in order to become brahma, kalpate, kalpate means he becomes fit. So he becomes eligible to be called brahma by that time. Because he is a person who has given up all these things, all the conditions which were told in 51, 52 and 53, all those conditions he has fulfilled. And he is staying in that state of nirmamatvam because of his purnatva, that is fullness, he is not seeking anything. Once you are identifying with the infinity, there is nothing to be aspired to be run after. Then shantaha, like nirindhana agnivat, another example given is, if you are putting suppose there is some fire, and I am adding some sticks. If I am adding some sticks, it will keep on firing. Suppose that indhanam is taken away, one after the other, I take away what are called the faggots, all those firewood. Suppose I take out that firewood, then naturally, nirindhana, that indhanam, that firewood is taken out. Once the firewood is taken out, that agni subsides. So like that, this gentleman also, when all these wishes, when all these things have gone away, all these desires, pursuits, they have gone away, then the person remains as, like the nirindhana agni, that is like the fire which has subsided. He is like that. So brahma bhuyaya kalpate. So he is a person who is fit for that state of brahmahood, if we can say. That is, he is one with that Brahman. The next shloka actually says brahma bhutaha. Brahma bhutaha means one who has become Brahman. So which means that 53, we have to take it as brahma bhuyaya kalpate means, brahma bhuyaya kalpate literally means he becomes, he is fit to become Brahma. So the next shloka says brahma bhutaha, he has already become Brahma. The next shloka let us read. What happens to that person who has become Brahman? We know that there is a rule in Vedanta, there is a saying, not saying, we can say, no, there is a rule. Brahmavit Brahmaiva Bhavati. A person who knows Brahma becomes Brahma. That means a person knowing Brahma means, what does it mean? Knows himself as Brahma. Knows himself as Brahma. Knowing, not knowing Brahma as an object. If I know Brahma as an external object, the person is not Brahma. Suppose I know, oh, this is Brahma. I know all that satyam jnanam anantam Brahma. Yo vedan hitam guhayam parame vyoman. I know all the mantras, let us say. Suppose I say some other mantras also, nishkalam, nishkriyam, shantam, etc., etc., shivam, advaitam. So many things I know, I can recite. But then, so long as I do not realize, so long as I do not feel that, yes, I am that. My sense is, whatever I call my own essence, but Shuddha Chaitanya is something which is not different from that, that Brahman. That is, the lakshyartha of me, the lakshyartha of tvam is not different from the lakshyartha of tat. So we have seen these terms earlier also. So which means, when I feel it, that I am not different from that, then a person becomes Brahma. He is not different from Brahma, because his individual ego has become zero, ahankara has become zero. And I have been saying repeatedly, when I say aham brahmasmi, when I means not I, when the jnani says aham brahmasmi, that is, jnani, he is in that state, I am Brahman. When he says like that, it is not an egotistical statement. This is something which we have to underline and remember. It is not an egotistical statement, it is not something which he is proudly proclaiming. He is only saying that everything, what all I see is Brahman. If I am Brahman, you are also Brahman. Even an ant is Brahma. What all I see, the whole universe is a manifestation in that Brahman. So he is at that state of awareness. So that is the reason why he has no love, he has no hate to anybody. Of course, love means he loves all the beings equally. He doesn't hate all the beings equally. When I say he loves all the beings equally, it does not mean that he hates all the beings equally. He has only love for her. Just as everybody loves his own Atma, he loves all the people without any condition. So it is a sort of unconditional love. So he doesn't hate anybody. That is what he is going to say in this 54th sloka. Brahma bhuta prasannatma na shochati na kankshati samas sarveshu bhuteshu mad bhaktim labhate param. Brahma bhuta is a person who has become Brahma. By doing what? By knowing about Brahma. By knowing about Brahma, he has realized that he is not different from that Brahma. When I realize that I am the king, then where is the difference between, there is no other king available, when I realize that I am that king. So it is like that. So Jnani Bhakta, in fact this is something, Mad Bhaktim Labhate Param. So Krishna is going to say in the same line, he attains my bhakti. So he is going to refer to that Jnani Bhakti, we will come to that. Brahma Bhutaha, then Prasannatma. Atma means the self, is Antahkarana here. Prasannatma is, he is not excited by anything. He is not exhilarated by some good thing. He is not overjoyed. He is not even joyed. He doesn't jump in joy. He doesn't cry in distress. So both are there. Both are. That means he takes with a sense of equanimity. So prasannatma, he is not agitated by anything, because he is with that infinite Brahma. That Atma is now that infinite Brahma. So this is that the sign of enlightenment is that a person is not getting excited by anything. Sukha dukhe same bhutva, earlier also right from the second chapter we have been seeing these words like sukha dukhe same bhutva something, sukha dukheshu, something like that we saw. That is, he is equal. He is not perturbed by something which is considered to be bad. He is not joyed or overjoyed by something which is considered to be a great success. So he is in that state of mind. That is, a prasannatma. Then, na shochati na kankshati. Na shochati means he has no shoka. Shoka means grief. Like Arjuna is having grief. Arjuna right now is grief stricken. And his grief has to be sorted out by giving him a big picture. So that is, Krishna, in the very beginning, he diagnosed the problem of Arjuna. And according to his diagnosis, apart from Atmajnana, nothing else is going to cure him of that illness. There is a beautiful line in Shankara Bhashyam in the very beginning. It is Ashochyan Anvashochastvam Prajnavadanscha Bhashase. There he says, Atmajnanad Anyatra Arjunasya Uddharanam Apashyan. He says, Arjunasya Uddharanam, that is lifting him from that ocean of sorrow. This man Arjuna is now submerged in that ocean of sorrow. And that from and that Arjuna has to be lifted up. Uddharanam. Uddharanam means up. Haranam means bringing up. Uddharanam. Krishna is not able to see any other solution. Krishna is not able to see any other solution like, okay, you go to this temple, you do this puja, you do this Rahu Ketu puja or some Shani Graha Shanti, etc., etc. He is not talking about any Graha Shanti. He is not talking about any ring, some particular gold ring, or he is not talking about Rudraksha, he is not talking about any other talisman, he is not talking about some Vastu Shanti, your house. Some people come and say your house is not perfect as per Vastu. Though we are absolutely peaceful, the problem with people is, suppose I build a house and I am perfectly happy with that. Some person comes and says, no, this is absolutely wrong, according to Vastu, something drastically going to happen. Then he is putting a seed of fear in my mind. So the best thing is, if you want to follow Vastu right from the beginning, you do something and then follow it. But otherwise, the best thing is not to see that at all, not to see, look into that aspect at all. If we are following Vastu from the point of view of aeration, etc., okay, I should have some nice aeration and I have to prevent too much of sun in the summer, particularly in India, we should not have too much of sun in the summer. So like that, we have to take some precautions. Apart from that, we need not bother about all those things. So anyway, na shochati. So shoka is due to moha. And Arjuna's problem was moha. Moha is delusion, wrong thinking. He is thinking, I am going to accrue a lot of sin. A lot of sin is going to come to me. All the whole clan is going to be destroyed, etc., etc. And he has forgotten about his dharma, and he wants to follow the Brahmana dharma, which is living by begging. Bhikshacharyam shreyo bhoktum bhaikshyam api haloke, he said. Shreyo bhoktum bhaikshyam api. Better to eat. Better to live by bhikshatanam. So that is what he was saying. So na shochati. So a wise man, a jnani, he does not grieve. He performs his action. Whatever swadharma is there, we have seen that shlokas earlier. Swadharma, even if it is having some little bit of trouble in it, even if it appears to be having some problems in it, a person has to do that. So na shochati and na kankshati. He doesn't desire anything. Doesn't desire anything. Then samaha sarveshu bhuteshu, and he is seeing that sama. Sama means we have seen this word sama. Sama means one meaning is equal. And in the Gita earlier we have come across sama buddhi, that is seeing Brahman in all things. Sama sarveshu bhuteshu, that means literally it is equal to all the beings. That is, he is able to see Brahman in all the beings. Sama sarveshu bhuteshu, then Mad bhaktim labhate param. So he attains my bhakti. Labhate means he attains. Mad bhaktim, he attains my bhakti. And what is that bhakti? Para bhakti, he is saying. What is that para bhakti and apara bhakti? Para means high, highest level of bhakti. Highest level of bhakti is not that which we see in huge temples. Some huge temples we find that they are almost like governments. They have thousands and thousands of crores of income. And they have got thousands and thousands of employees, and then they spend a lot of money on various things. So, lot of paraphernalia. Suppose you put some poor tons of ghee on the idols, and some lorry loads of flowers, etc., are brought. Some lorry loads of fruits, etc., they are brought and they are put there. So, all that, okay, that is a great puja, is such a fantastic thing, such a spectacle. It's a great spectacle, but that is not parabhakti. That becomes a spectacle only. So parabhakti is not doing all that. And sometimes we see Swamiji is declaring, oh, I have performed puja with 10 tons of ghee. So we are performing puja with so many tons of something else. So sometimes even the Swamijis, they do like that. So madbhaktim labhate param, parabhakti, the commentators say, parabhakti is only atma jnana nishtha. Parabhakti is to be in that awareness of Brahman, that is jnana nishtha lakshana bhakti. Whenever he say parabhakti, we have to go back to that earlier shloka. In the fourth chapter, he talked about artho jignyasu arthaarthi, fourth chapter or fifth or sixth somewhere. Artho jignyasu chaturvidha bhajante maam janas sukrutino arjuna. So that is the shloka. Chaturvidha bhajante maam. It starts like that. Artho jignyasu arthaarthi. So that is a person in distress. He is called artha. Jignyasu, a person who wants to know. Arthaarthi, a person who is not in distress, but he wants some more progress. He is fairly well settled, but he wants something more. He wants some more success. So he is arthaarthi. And then the fourth type is jnani. So now we are talking about the fourth type of bhakta. A jnani who is not different from Brahman. So staying in that jnana nishtha is parabhakti. That is, he is loving God as much as he loves himself. So that is it. His relationship with God is not in terms of duality. So parabhakti is not in terms of duality. Suppose I say I am loving means there is an object of love. So but here there is no other object of love. He is one with that Brahman, and there is no staying in that awareness itself is love. Staying in that awareness itself is bhakti. That is what is jnana, jnani bhakti. So that is not in the mode of duality. So normal bhakti is we are offering some naivedyam, and then so huge naivedyam, etc. And very elaborate procedures are also described. Usually what happens is very elaborate procedures in all our pujas. Sometimes depending on the money we spend, the quantity of procedure also enhances. If you are paying 1,000 rupees, the procedure is some. If you are paying 2,000 rupees, there is more procedure and more naivedyam, etc., more prasadam is given at the end of the puja. So all these things, that is not parabhakti. That is okay. That is at the lower level for an ordinary man. It will satisfy him. It will also give him some consolation. So long as it gives a consolation to the common man, it is okay. But then a seeker, he is not supposed to be contented at that level. So then, madbhaktim labhate param. So he says, jnana nishtha lakshana bhakti. So we'll continue tomorrow. Harihi om tat sat.